last week was a lot of fun. We talked about just. And we looked at a woman who had lost her husband. It was a widow of a prophet. And Elisha told her, instructed her to go to her neighbors and get as many empty vessels as possible and not what? Not what? Not just a few. Oh, yeah. That's right. Oh, yeah. Not just a few, but to get your hands on as many empty vessels as possible. It was a fun morning last week. I talked with Pastor Bill afterwards. Whenever they are here, I usually make my way over to them and kind of do that. Was that okay? Was that good? Because I value their input, and he was so excited. He goes, that word, I've landed on that word with the staff in the past years, because we had this great conversation about how we I'm lumping all of us together in this. When we pray, we often pray with a lot of justs in our prayer, in our prayers. Lord, would you just be with that family? Or Lord, would you just do this or just do that? And it's such a reducing word in our prayers. If there's any coaching that I could give with our prayer life, it would be this: if we could just get rid of just in our prayers. Instead of saying, Lord, would you just heal that knee? We would say, Jesus, heal that knee. There's more power and more authority in it than, Lord, if you just could, if you just might, if it's just not a bother, get that out of your prayers and start praying without the just and pray with boldness. And sometimes it's also a filler. Some of us that are early in our, you know, praying out loud, we have fillers. And sometimes we say, Lord, a lot, as if he needs to be reminded of who he is. Lord, would you just, we thank you, Lord, for this great day, Lord, and Lord, we pray, Lord. And he's like, I know who I am. Just say what you need to say. It's some of y'all singing John Mayer. Stop. But just say what you need to say. Lord Jesus, be with this family. Lord Jesus, move on their behalf. Speak with boldness. Pray with boldness. We have a God who is eager and willing to hear us. So, Bill and I, we agreed that I should, throw that out there this morning, encourage us in our prayers. Today we're going to look at two other instances where the word just is used. Now, I threw that out there to you, don't use it, yet we're going to look at where it's appropriate. So, forgive me, if I make it more confusing by the time you leave, just do your best, okay? We're all in agreement there. So we're going to look at Mark chapter 5, two stories wrapped up in one moment. One of them is a woman who had a condition of bleeding for 12 years, and then there was a synagogue ruler whose daughter was very, very sick, on the verge of death. And there are some instances of the word just in these two stories wrapped up in one. So if you are there, Mark chapter 5, we're going to start in verse 21. Now, Jesus had already done some pretty remarkable things. He healed a demon-possessed man at this other region, and they had gotten in a boat, and they were making their way back over to where they had launched from. And this is where we pick up, Mark chapter 5, verse 21. When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd, everybody say, large crowd. A large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue rulers named Jairus, whichever you prefer, came there. Seeing Jesus, he fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with him. Jesus hadn't even barely got out of the boat, and you have a synagogue ruler on his knees at Jesus' feet saying, my daughter, my little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live. So Jesus went with him. Now, mind you, we have to keep in mind that there is a large crowd. Everybody say, large crowd. There's a large crowd right there when Jesus, their boat lands. There's a large crowd when the synagogue ruler gets on his knees. There's a large crowd that went with them. We're going to pick up. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and spent all she had. Sounds familiar with the widow last week, where she had gotten rid of everything in the house and all she had was a little bit of oil. All this woman had was a little bit of faith. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. It says this, when she heard about Jesus, we have no details about what she heard of Jesus. We just know that she heard about Jesus. I would imagine that she heard that there's a man named Jesus who is healing people, healing demon-possessed, healing people of leprosy. She had to have known that he wasn't just a prophet or some random person, but he was somebody who could do something about the condition that she had. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought in her mind, if I just, everybody say just. Say just as if it's the coolest word you've ever said. Say just. If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately, her bleeding stopped. And she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" You see the people crowding against you, his disciples answered, and yet you ask, "Who touched me?" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." We're going to stop right here. The story continues, and we're going to pick up the story in a little bit. We have here the story of yet another woman who is desperate. Last week, we looked at the widow who was desperate in her own situation, her own reality, and we have a new woman here who was subject to bleeding, and it was in the female parts and the female organs, and she had gone to whatever lengths that she could go to resolve it and get answers and find solutions, and nothing was no answers could be found. And she heard about Jesus. She heard about this man, this one who spoke the words of God, who whenever he went places, people's lives were changed, and she heard about him. And so you get a picture of her demeanor. Some of us, if we are in desperate need of something, would we not plant ourselves in his face and say, "Jesus," cry out to him, saying, "Jesus, help me. Help me, Lord. I need your help. I need your answers. I need your touch." But there's a lot of insight into her approach to getting to Jesus. Now, it's important to know that in those days, if with someone that's going through her condition, they were pegged and labeled as unclean, socially unclean. And she was not supposed to touch people because of her uncleanness. Can you imagine walking around in life that way? Some of us walk that way. We have labeled ourselves as unclean, and so we walk with that identity as unclean. I can't approach God. I can't go to him because I'm filthy. This approach shows her humility. It also shows her humiliation, her embarrassment. I'm going to follow him and work my way through the crowd and try to touch him unnoticed. Now, what's interesting about this, I had you say large crowd for a couple purposes. Because there are people around Jesus pressing in on him. And if I have some visual for you, this is actually, I don't know if this is what it was like, but this is kind of the imagery that comes to my mind about these pressing in and moving in on Jesus. It kind of looks like this to me. It's just, wait, it gets better.
Hi.
They're not moving in, so this guy's like, oh, I better do something. And then a fourth guy comes in. I'm gonna help out too. I mean, look at the guy in the back. Look how crazy that is. So I have no idea if that's what it was like for the people. Like, just press in. Get around Jesus. Get in there. I would pass out right there. I'm claustrophobic, tight spaces. That's why I don't go to Michael's. I don't go to any, like, knick-knack stores because the aisles are too narrow and the smells are too much. And I, like, things start getting distant from me and I about pass out. I just don't like close things. But we get this picture where, or what's the store? Benjamin Franklin. Oh, my Lord. I can't even go in there. Oh, my Lord. That must have been what it was like. When your shoulders touch both sides of the aisle when you're walking down the aisle, that should not happen. So these people are leaning in. Now listen to this. This is so stinking important. There are people pressing in and touching Jesus all around. What's so unique about this one woman that doesn't even touch his skin? She touches the edge of his cloak. And it was her touch that power left him and healed her. I think Jesus is the same today where he knows. He's here. Y'all, this is his church. This is his place. He can tell a difference between those that come nonchalantly, just want to rub shoulders with Jesus just for the feel good for the week, versus those who are calling out and crying out to him. He knows the difference. Which one are you? That's why we start with the question, why are you here? Are you here just for a casual stroll where you just want to rub shoulders and get your feel good with Jesus, or do you really need him? Y'all, none of us are perfect. Even when our life seems like all the pieces have fit together and things are going well, we still need him. It doesn't change our need for him. But yet, when something happens, when tragedy strikes, or when the unexpected happens, or when there's reason for us to call out above and beyond what we normally do, there's something about how he, we sang about it, how he, what, loves us. And the woman didn't even ask. She had a thought. She thought in her mind, if I can just touch the edge of his garment, I'll be freed from my suffering. Which one are you? Are you about the casual stroll? Are you those that are leaning in and you're bumping into him and you're there, but you have really no need for him? You just want to be associated with him. And it's not wrong to be associated with him. We want to acknowledge him before men. That's all good and right. But maybe I could borrow last week's empty vessel approach. Maybe we're not digging in, and maybe we're not finding those empty vessels where we need to touch Jesus so that he can fill our vessels. Which one are you? Why are you here? Jesus, knowing something, knowing power had gone out from him, he asks, who just touched me? We would respond no different than the disciples responded. What are you talking about, Jesus? Bro, we're like around masses of people. Your question makes no sense. And he ignores them, and he keeps looking. He keeps looking. Have any of you ever done something that was questionable, maybe when you're younger, and you go through the process of truth being revealed? How many of you are the ones that just come right out and say, I did it, it was me? How many of you are on the other side, you just want to see how it plays out to see if somebody gets caught, if you get caught? How many of you are like that, truthfully? Raise your hand if you're like that. The rest of you are just too embarrassed to raise your hand because, okay, you're still in that group. Okay. I was one of those that I was like, let's just see if my brother or sister gets in trouble so I don't get the blame. That's how I rolled. This woman was waiting patiently, hoping that Jesus, the Son of God, with whom is all power, he is all powerful. Talk about self-awareness. Somebody touches his clothes and he knows power goes out of him. And he waits until this woman is gripped with this, I have to answer him. I know that I'm healed. I'm changed. I'm free. And so she comes to him, and it says this, that she fell at his feet, trembling with fear. But wait a minute, she heard about this guy. She heard about him. Why would she tremble in fear? She was just miraculously healed. Why wasn't she coming to him with thankfulness? She was coming to him with fear. She came and fell at his feet, trembling with fear, and told him the whole truth. This is so God. We have to catch this. This woman, by social standards, is unclean. And if we can learn anything, we can learn what he says to her. He says to this unclean woman, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. He relabels her. Do y'all get that? This woman comes broken, embarrassed, humiliated because of her condition. I'm sure after 12 years, people know her issue. That's what she's walked with. That's what she's talked with. That's what she's been associated by. And Jesus calls her daughter. That is so God. What were the disciples' response? They're like, don't bother. There's people all around you. They missed it. All the other masses, they missed it. I love what Jesus shows us and reveals us about the heart of God. What did we read several weeks ago? It's the sick that need a doctor, not the healthy, right? And so as he's saying this, we're going to continue on. As he's saying these words, as he's literally saying, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go and be freed from your suffering. There's an interruption in his, as he's saying this, there's an interruption. While Jesus was speaking, some men came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler. Remember him? That's where we started. That's the guy who started at his feet. Jairus was at Jesus' feet to begin with. Like, I gotta get down to your feet. And he knelt down, and that's where he started. The woman ended that way. Interesting. And he says, your daughter is dead. Sounds pretty brutal, right? No sugarcoating that. Your daughter's dead. Why bother the teacher anymore? Ignoring what they said, Jesus told the synagogue ruler, don't be afraid. Just believe. Just believe. Just my daughter's dead, and you're just believe. Don't be afraid. Just believe. How many things are you facing, or how many things have gone on in your past where you've second guessed yourself? Where you've looked at the reality of what's in front of you and you're thinking, there's no possible way. There's no possible way. It's and fear swells up. We today need to hear Jesus say these words, don't be afraid. Just believe. There's decisions that you've probably made in the past. There's actions that you've taken. There's probably ways that were to say it PC, to say it correctly, and to say it nicely, there's things that were opposite of what would honor God. And they are but moments. You need to understand this. They are but moments. They don't define you. So many of us we choose to be defined by moments in our life. And we don't even realize, and we don't even see the bigger picture. Can I just speak to parents in here real quick? Parents, whether you're grandparent, parent, or soon-to-be parent, listen, the grandparents, don't y'all know that there are moments where you blew it as a parent? Current parents, don't y'all know that there's moments where you've blown it as a parent? Expectant parents, you're hopeful and you want to be the first perfect parent ever. But it's just not going to happen. But you're perfectly you because you stuck with it. And I feel like there's a lot of people who live in regret of something, any number of things. I was watching this movie that captures this so well. I don't know if any of you have seen if any of y'all have seen Moneyball, but there's a scene in Moneyball where I forget the roles in the movie, but they're watching film, and there's a baseball player that they're watching who has a fear of rounding to second base. He's a big guy. He doesn't turn corners well. And so this time, they're watching this film where he's going to do it for the first time. He's going to step out and do something for the first time. And he doesn't even realize what's fully happening. I want you to watch this clip.
The Visalia Oaks and our 240-pound catcher, Jeremy Brown, who, as you know, is scared to run to second base. This was in a game 6 weeks ago. This guy's going to start him off with a fastball. Jeremy's going to take him to deep center. Here's what's really interesting. Because Jeremy's going to do what he never does. He's going to go for it. He's going to round first, and he's going to go for it. Okay? This is all of Jeremy's nightmares coming to life.
Oh, they're laughing at him.
And Jeremy's about to find out why. Jeremy's about to realize that the ball went 60 feet over the fence. He hit a home run and didn't even realize it.
As powerful of a clip as that is, there are so many people who walk life thinking that their ball is in the infield when you've been hitting home runs. You think that you're on the ground scurrying, just trying to conduct yourself and make yourself look, I don't know what, but you think you failed. You failed. I'm just gonna get back to first base. You don't even realize you've been hitting home runs. And the falling isn't what defines. As the clip goes on, he gets up and he starts running around the bases, kind of jumping up and down, kind of redeeming the situation. But y'all, fear will sometimes make it look like we're going to get tripped up. We're going to get tripped up by opposition. We're going to get tripped up by our own mind. We're going to think little of ourselves. We're going to diminish ourselves, or we're going to think that what we're facing is bigger than what it really is. But y'all, you need to understand that if you're just touching the edge of his garment, that's hitting home runs right there. Your desperation and your calling out and your crying out and you realizing that Jesus is the answer for everything and everything that you face and all the challenges that you go through, whether that's loss of loved ones or current realities in the home or education. That was super stressful for me because I was always pegged a C student. There's so many ways that we think about ourselves that if we just believe and if we just touch the edge of his cloak, the edge of his garment, that's hitting home runs right there. We may not see it, But in a whole other dimension, in a whole other realm, we are hitting home runs. Hang in there. Push through the crowds. And if you are in the crowd, don't be the crowd that just casually bumps up to Jesus. Be the one who is pushing through the crowd despite being unclean, despite being labeled something. Push your way through that crowd to be at the edge of his garment. Be that person. Keep swinging, keep striving, keep reaching. If we live in this just reality, I pray that it is not, I want just enough. I pray that it's not that. I pray that it is, I just want to touch Jesus. I just want to touch what he's wearing. That's the just that I hope we live out in this church. Can we do something this morning? Can we stand to our feet? I want us to sing How He Loves Us. Just the chorus. And we need to be reminded that in the same way that this is how crazy Jesus is. Even when he seems to be unaware and not engaging a person, he's still meeting their need. Isn't that crazy? That even when Jesus isn't looking at this woman, he healed her. His power healed. That's how big his love, that's how much capacity he has to meet our needs. Can we be reminded this morning of not just how he loves us? I love that the author of this song, the writer of this song, didn't just say he loves us, he loves us, he loves us, but he loves us. Oh, how he loves us.